So good morning and good afternoon to everyone, and thank you for joining us today. My name is Susan Spronk, Associate Professor at the School of International Development and Global Studies at the University of Ottawa. I will be moderating today's discussion. I'd like to begin by acknowledging that I'm joining today from the traditional unceded territory of the Algonquin Anishinaabeg people. This land has been inhabited by Indigenous people from the beginning. We are grateful for the opportunity to meet here, and we thank all of the generations of people who have been stewards of this land for thousands of years. We are all treaty people. Many of us have come as settlers, newcomers in this generation and generations past. Thank you to all for joining us here in our webinar about blended finance. Excuse me. First, some housekeeping. So you may notice that this webinar is being recorded. You are welcome to watch it later on our website or also to share it with your networks. We are offering simultaneous interpretation. You should see a language option in the toolbar at the bottom of your screen where you can choose French interpretation. Throughout the webinar, we will be posting links in the chat that will take you to more resources, including our Blended Finance Project website. I'd also welcome you to post in the chat, share your thoughts, your comments, and ask questions. Please feel free to use this space to engage with the panelists or other participants joining us today. This webinar has been organized by a group of unions, non-governmental organizations, and academics who are concerned about the Canadian government's embrace of what is called blended finance. I'd like to begin by helping people understand what blended finance is. This may be a review for those of you who joined us for our first webinar that was held in late March. So blended finance is the strategic use of development finance for the mobilization of additional finance towards sustainable development in developing countries. While it sounds nice, what this really means is that public money, including foreign aid, is being used to leverage private sources of capital. This generates a number of adverse consequences that our speakers today will elaborate on. Blended finance has been promoted in Europe for over a decade now, but the Canadian government has also jumped on board in recent years in the name of promoting the Sustainable Development Goals, or the SDGs. The SDGs are an ambitious set of targets for development that countries of the United Nations have promised to meet by 2030. The Canadian government has taken a number of steps to promote this new agenda, including the creation of FinDev in 2017, whose mandate is to support inclusive private sector growth through blended finance initiatives. In addition, Canada is one of the main sponsors of the Convergence Platform, which calls itself the Global Network for Blended Finance and is headquartered in Toronto. The federal government has also made significant changes to Canada's definition of official development assistance, or ODA, and introduced a new International Financial Assistance Act and committed $1.5 billion to facilitate innovative and blended financing approaches to ODA. In the recently released 2021 federal budget, the government has made further commitments to multilateral development banks and recapitalized FinDev Canada, keeping with these trends of privatizing international aid. Today, we are going to be focusing on the gendered impact of the privatization of foreign aid. In 2017, the government announced that it was launching a feminist international assistance policy. As part of this policy, the government announced that by next year, no less than 95% of Canada's bilateral international development assistance initiatives will target or integrate gender equality and the empowerment of women and girls. As our colleagues at Cooperation Canada observe, while 95% of development bilateral assistance in some way integrates gender equality objectives, only about 6% of it has gender equality as its main objective. On top of this, there remains a lack of clarity around how the integration of gender equality objectives is defined and measured, and importantly today, how this target intersects with blended finance. So today our webinar will be focusing on the gendered effects of a subset of blended finance initiatives. that may be familiar to many of our listeners, public-private partnerships, PPPs or P3s. While there are no universally accepted definitions, the term PPP usually refers to a type of project, and in particular, the contractual aspects of the relationship between the parties involved. By contrast, definitions of blending usually refer to relationships between different forms of finance. For example, ODA combined with public or private finance and generally pay little attention to the actual parties involved. The main reason P3s are mentioned in discussions about blended finance is because of initiatives that use blending as a way to finance P3s. To be clear, they are both forms of privatization. So today's discussion will be divided into two parts. In the first part, our panelists will help us understand the concerns and dangers of privatization, and in particular, the impact of public-private partnerships on women's human rights. In the second part, we'll discuss alternatives. So without further ado, I'm very glad to welcome two guests today. As we come together to talk about this concerning turn in Canadian policy, they are going to help us understand what the experience has been in the economic South, and we'll dive into a case study from Sierra Leone. As I mentioned, in the second half of our webinar, we'll discuss alternatives and a better way forward. So first we'll be hearing from Masaya Yavaneras Blanco. Masaya is from DAWN, the Development Alternatives with Women for a New Era. And she's also an incoming assistant professor of development studies at Huron University College at University of Western Ontario. She is joining us today from Fredericton, New Brunswick, Canada. We'll also hear from Husanato Abdullah, or Husai for short, who is an independent gender and development researcher and consultant with over two decades of experience on the African continent, especially West Africa. Husai is joining us today from Freetown, Sierra Leone. Welcome to both, and thank you so much for joining us today. So let's start with Masaya. Masaya, you played a coordinating role in DAWN's recently published report, PPPs and Women's Human Rights, Feminist Analysis from the Global South. The report presents the findings from case studies of P3s in major infrastructure projects and services traditionally provided by the state. This includes services and infrastructure like hospitals, schools, railways, water, and energy. The case studies from around the globe, including Peru, Fiji, India, Sierra Leone, and Zimbabwe. So a very wide range of both types of PPPs and of countries where they're taking place. Masaya, based on your findings, can you help us better understand how privatization has particularly negative effect on women in the economic South?
Well, Susan, thanks so much for the introduction. And before anything else, I wanted to thank the Blended Finance Initiative for reaching out to DAWN to share our research with you. DAWN's work with on public-private partnerships stems from the need to produce evidence-based feminist analysis on this development model that is being advanced by international development institutions. And also, it's important for us to hold northern countries accountable for the type of development that is being funded by the development models that are being put forward. All this to say that we're very happy to share our research with peers in Canada, from other social movements, from unions, and of course from with academic colleagues. So when thinking about PPPs from a feminist perspective and from the perspective of women's human rights, and there are some points that come to mind that are our main messages. First, I think it's clear and it's very important to think about the issue that when it comes to PPPs, the foremost concern is that public needs and public policies are made into business opportunities. So social needs turn into business niches, which in turn create the wrong set of incentives. We can agree, for example, that it would be profit what shareholders in a corporation will be looking after, whereas we expect governments to protect and guarantee human rights. So the two logics are in conflict with each other and create terrible outcomes in terms of human rights. And a clear example of this is the implementation of PPPs in the health sector. We see a rise of C-sections and hysterectomies that are not desirable even in the best or even the best medical practice in certain contexts. And however, these surgeries keep popping up in context of privatization because they are more profitable medical procedures. And this is exactly what we've seen in our research in India, for example, with the implementation of the PPP model in the National Health Insurance Scheme. Invasive surgeries with significant consequences are being carried out among racialized and indigenous women in communities of lower income without proper consent, and even in circumstances where they are not medically advisable. So again, the logic of the PPPs imposes different principles in the logic of public service delivery. PPPs often implement fees in the service delivery, which again creates a problem of access and exercise of human rights. In the case of the insurance scheme in India, which is also perhaps the largest PPP in India, which is considerable considering the size of India, we find that even if the services in principle are being provided without cost for communities for lower income communities, we find that on the ground fees are being imposed, thus reducing access to basic health services and often criminalizing people who cannot afford their services. And this is something we find not only in India, but for example, in Zimbabwe, where women are held in the hospital when they're unable to pay specific fees that they are simply in no capacity to cover for. The case of Zimbabwe is significant also because the diversification of the services that came along the PPP with fee-paying services for those who could pay in principle, and also some services that were supposed to be provided without fee. However, the same personnel was supposed to provide both lines of service, thus leaving those who couldn't pay for last and reducing their chances of survival in some cases. This, of course, has an impact on maternal mortality and infant mortality. One key characteristic that is problematic across the board in all the case studies that we developed is that the contracts are negotiated with significant opacity. In the cases where the contracts are available, which are exceptional, those reports that are supportive of the contract that inform, for example, the cost analysis, the environmental impact of the projects, those reports aren't available. And here, it's important to think also and to point out that a lot of the organizations that are at the forefront requiring the increased transparency and access to documentation are public unions, especially unions of public nurses. This is something we find in Peru. This is something we find in Fiji, for example. And finally, something that is critical is that PPPs are backed with public money. So the risk implied in certain investments is made public. It is the public who is bearing the brunt of certain risks that come with large investments. However, profit isn't made public. Profit is private. So there is a clear unequal terms of the game here, especially in countries with very limited policy space based on the conditions of the financial, the international financial systems and the levels of international debt. A case in point here is the issue of one of Senegal's major highways, which we included in our study, which ended up costing about 5 to 6 times the expected amount, which again was something that was covered with the public purse. So it's an issue of transparency, it's an issue of accountability, and it has a direct impact in terms of human lives.
Thanks, Masaya. So let's turn to Hussai. So Hussai, let's dive a bit deeper into the impacts of privatization on marginalized groups and communities, including on women in Sierra Leone. So you contributed a chapter in Dawn's book on an agro-energy firm in Sierra Leone. Can you tell us about what happened with this P3 and on what was the impact on women?
Yes, ADAX Bioenergy Sierra Leone was initiated in 2008, and it started off with a 10,000 acre land to build an ethanol factory to supply ethanol to the European Union, and the promise also to sell renewable energy to the government of Sierra Leone. And this is a bit of I'm going to digress a bit. Sierra Leone has had an energy problem since the late 90s. And it is one of the most, one of the least countries with energy access in West Africa. And obviously people were very happy, but this Ajax, when it was inaugurated, it was touted as not only the best, the largest agricultural and energy project in Sierra Leone, but also in Africa, that would encourage other governments to develop PPPs in different sectors. Unfortunately, that didn't happen. By 2015, first of all, what happened was that there was no informed consent from the landowners. And whilst the government was pushing the landowners to sign on behalf of the donors, civil society was also trying to let the people know, the landowners and land users, that they shouldn't accept because the contract is not in their favor. And the government was very angry. It must be said that where ADAX is the home of the former president. So for him, it was a sense of pride. He wanted it in his hometown. And they forced the people of Makeni and its environs to ensure that ADAX is there. And by 2015, ADAX shut down because of various reasons, low sugarcane yields. And I was told by someone that even when the people told the ADAX people that, look, the soil here is not good for sugarcane, they refused because the president wanted it. It was a pet project of his. It was not a project for national development. I don't know what it was for, but it wasn't something that people wanted. And by 2015, various factors ethanol price crashed in the EU. So it meant they cannot make the necessary profit they envisage. Secondly, also, the yield was low. Thirdly, the outbreak of Ebola. And because of that, everything just crashed. When that crashed, and every other thing, ADAX started winding down. What happened was all the DFIs, the development finance institutions, both European and African, got their money back. ADAX was sold to Sunbird Bioenergy. Sunbird has been criticized for being a shoddy outfit with very shoddy finances and no expertise to enter into the market. And by 2018, they started production and they diverted from sugarcane to cassava. By using cassava, which is a staple across the country, it meant food insecurity would increase. And also, Sunbird was very anti-workers. ADAX would talk with the workers and their representatives and with NGOs that were monitoring on behalf of the people. But Sunbird was just adamant and never wanted to talk to anybody. They were just willing to do what they think they can do. And with cassava, yes, nothing happened. And all the social projects to ensure that both women and male workers had farms and other facilities all came to an end. And people were not paid enough. And by the few people who were left after the Ebola crisis were wiped out from the company with the coronavirus. And Sunbird has now sold off to Brown's Energy, a Sri Lankan company. So whilst the companies were changing hands and the DFIs collected their monies, the people who suffered most were the people in the area. And women suffered the most. This area, Northern Sierra Leone, is the most, is the least developed of the regions in Sierra Leone. Sierra Leone is divided into four regions: Western area, Northern province, Eastern province, yeah, and Western rural, and Southern province. And in the South and part of the East, women can own land, but in the North, they cannot own land at all. And when ADAX came, the women lost even the customary rights they had. That is, you can take care, you have user rights from your male relations, be it your father, your husband, your brother, and whoever it is, a male relation. And also there's a thing in Sierra Leone that strangers can come and rent land. But with the change in ownership, it became very difficult for women. And as a result, people were moving out of the area to other areas. So people who had access to land, even men, because the compensation was so low the land became infertile because of all the chemicals. People moved, and also the company itself relocated people, which violated their terms of engagement in the area. And for women, it meant they had to work harder to get more food. They also have to ration food. People went from having 3 meals in a day to 1. And also kids had to ration the portions for children. So what that means, apart from the general food insecurity, it also led to malnutrition, increased poverty, stunting amongst children. And so the situation in that, and that area is also a very poor area. So it meant they became poorer because of ADACs. But in spite of all of the social impact on the poor, especially women and children, the middle class, the chiefs, made money, and the government. And the former government had more representatives in parliament. So they were able to push through everything. And it's not only with ADACs. There are lots of large scale farming now taking place across the country. And what you have, they're talking of agribusiness. It's not for people to eat, it's agribusiness, how they can sell abroad. What can we make and produce that can be sold abroad here? That's
fine. Thank you so much, Asai. I'd just like to also take a chance to remind people to use the chat to share any thoughts or questions that you have and as they come up, and we're going to try to get to them later in the webinar. So thank you so much for that overview. Messiah, I want to turn to you now and dive a bit deeper into this agenda of the donor countries like Canada. Donor countries are talking about gender equality, but pursuing policies of privatization. And everything you've said up to now seems to suggest that these two policy objectives are not compatible and indeed contradict each other. So can you tell us a bit more about why you think that these policy objectives contradict each other in about 2 minutes?
Thank you, Susan. I'll try to be brief. I think to begin with, it's important to think about what constitutes gender equality and what feminism we're thinking about. For us, feminism is closely linked to women's rights and gender rights, but also environmental justice and economic justice, as well as political freedoms and political rights. So we have to think about these things in an intersectional, interlinked manner. Turning risk into a public risk, or turning financial risk into public risk, is not a feminist policy. Especially because the costs, the risks, and the costs involved in many of these investments are often covered by increased unpaid work, increased unpaid work by women and girls, especially in communities that are already marginalized. Imposing infrastructure development without proper prior and informed consent is not possibly feminist policy. Framing the state responsibility to guarantee social and economic rights into a business opportunity, what really is doing is often increasing the vulnerabilities of groups that we are supposed to be, providing and guaranteeing rights for. And we're seeing that racialized women, women who live in poverty, women workers are especially affected, and women farmers are especially affected in many of these transactions, are some of the groups that are the last in line in those consultations that actually get to take place. When there are consultations, those often ignore cultural practices. They often ignore gender distinctions within communities, and these often simply reproduces forms of exclusion that increase marginalization rather than work towards social and a more democratic form of development.
Great, thanks, Masaya. Hussai, I've understood that a major focus of your work and your life's passion has been fighting for equality, human rights, and social justice, predominantly in West Africa, but also across the continent. You've described very well some of the ways that privatization has increased inequality and disadvantages our society's most vulnerable, the case study in Sierra Leone. What do you think privatization has meant in West Africa, and particularly, what has it meant for government's ability to pursue their own alternative development paths in about 2 minutes?
Privatization in West Africa has actually destroyed the social fabric, the immediate social fabric of the post-colonial states. The immediate social fabric of the post-colonial states focused on giving free education, healthcare, good public services to develop the citizenry, to take over governance. But with privatization that started in the 1980s with the structural adjustment programs, all the gains of the immediate post-colonial society were rolled back. And that's when people started talking about the retrenchment of the state or the rolling back of the state, as now user fees were introduced in hospitals, in schools, electricity and water rates were hiked up. So it meant that the poor were really now suffering. People were dropping out of school. People were being retrenched from work. And for women, there were not many in the formal sector, but through the first-in, first-out policy that even unions were negotiating, women were the first to, they were the last to get into the workforce, but they're the first to let go of. And husbands too were being retrenched in the formal sector. So it meant there was less money in the households. So what you have is increased poverty. And with the lack of social responsibility now globally, it means that poverty globally is increasing, but it is worse in the global south. And in a place like West Africa, it's West Africa in terms of the African region seem to be West Africa seem to be really behind in so many things. So with privatization and everything, it became worse. I'm right now in Sierra Leone. You don't enjoy electricity for more than 4 hours, and getting solar energy, unlike Dakar, that the price is coming down, unlike Senegal, in Sierra Leone, it's increasing. So even with upper middle class people, it's difficult for you to even navigate and enjoy most of these facilities. So the government itself has just shirked its responsibilities, and international development organizations, because ADB, the African Development Bank, that is, you would expect, should not have been part or should have ensured that ADAX worked, was quick to retrieve its money. But in their own projects, generally, you always have quotas for women, this, but there was nothing in McKinney.
Great, thank you. So now a part I've really been looking forward to, which is our lightning round. So I have a challenge for each of you. You have no more than 1 minute to share one or two key lessons that we've learned from your research on P3s that can be applied to gender justice and development. And let's go in reverse order this time and have Husai and then Messiah. Husai.
I'm sorry. The way PPPs are going, there is nothing you can, because they're working up, it's contradictory to each other. Gender justice and PPPs cannot go together. So actually, what we, maybe in other places, what we're seeing in West Africa, you see that most women are being let go of in the society. Women are suffering. You have high maternal mortality. I think Sierra Leone even has the highest in the world. High infant mortality rate. And things that simple procedures, people die. So there is nothing that PPPs are doing in any sector. Growing up, we were told certain things. Now you just realize your standard of living is deteriorating instead of improving. Yeah.
Great, thanks, Messiah.
I think one of the main risks that come with PPPs, not only in terms of the social costs that are significant, as Husai has made so clear, is also that it sells the idea that, you know, the private sector is an equal partner to the state and to the public sector, which is problematic in many ways. We have to remember that the public sector is to be accountable for the population, for the electorate, and it's supposed to guarantee human rights. And corporations are accountable to their shareholders. So the logics are not the same, and it's rather problematic when we are told, you know, that we're partners in development. That partnership isn't an equal partnership, especially when we're talking about governments in the global south and corporations from the global north. And on the other hand, I think it's important to remember there is not a niche on, you know, within development that is a feminist niche. The whole idea of development and development models is a feminist quandary, is a question that feminists deal with. So we have to use that lens as we discuss development finance at large.
Great, fantastic. That was really great, and it gives us a lot to think about and some concrete steps to take. So before we turn to our second part on our discussion on alternatives, I'd like to take a minute to look at what's being shared in the webinar's chat. Emily, who's from the Canadian Labour Congress, has been closely following the discussion happening there. Emily, can you share a bit of what you're hearing in the chat?
Sure thing, and a huge thanks to those who have been putting their questions into the chat. Some good questions coming up. So we had a question from Olufun Milayo. It's a question about raising aid funds more generally. So I think this could go to both of our panelists. The question is, given that raising aid is becoming more difficult, how do we prevent the issues of P3s while also ensuring that people do not go without? What is the other alternative? And so I think we're going to get into this in the second half of the webinar. So great question. We also have a question from Barry Pinsky. I think this is more targeted to Husai. Was there any international aid or investment in the Sierra Leone case? And then we also have a third question from James Delaney. Along with the Government of Canada's attempted use of blended finance is the development of small mechanisms for sovereign loans. Would the panelists comment on that? Would you see this as an alternative to leveraging private capital? So again, great, as we move into the second part of the webinar on alternatives. And then I'm just seeing a fourth question coming in from Saeed. So the question is, how do you achieve the SDGs without private sector involvement, especially when the private sector is the biggest income and employment generator? So I think this is good question connected to that first one. Questions about how do we raise funds without the private sector more generally. So I'll leave it at those three questions. And again, thanks, a huge thanks to everyone for putting their comments and questions in the chat.
Great, and as a moderator, I'm going to ask our speakers to take very brief answers to those questions because we're really gonna get more into the alternatives and raising alternative money in the second half. So let's give each of our speakers 2 minutes and then we'll turn to the alternatives. Messiah, do you wanna go first?
I'll do that. I think we will have a little bit more time to talk about the alternatives, but I'm not familiar with the small mechanism for sovereign loans. So I'm sorry, I cannot address that point. I need to do more research. And with regards with the idea of how do we do to raise funds without PPPs or without the private sector. I think this is a complex question. The problem is not the private sector per se. I think the private sector is a valid actor. It's the conditions under which the private sector comes in. I think it is problematic to think that private sector and the state are on an equal footing and also on an equal plane in terms of how and development is carried out. And this brings up issues of governance, and not only among private sector and governments, but also within governments, because we live in a rather unequal world. So I think multilateralism, it's an important space to work with. And there are initiatives, for example, as the binding treaty, where there are civil society organizations from around the globe trying to find proper regulation mechanisms that address the participation of the private sector in ways that are really respectful of human rights rather than opaque and arbitrary.
Great, thank you. Usai?
Yes, there was no direct money there was no direct ODA money within ADAX, but you have the DFIs, European DFIs and the African DFIs. Like I mentioned, the African Development Bank was there, but it never worked for the people. Instead, all of them quickly took out their monies when you realize the project wasn't going to move forward. So there's this problem of who are they obligated to? Is it their investors or the people? And that is the problem we're having. And in terms of SDGs and the private sector, in Africa, the public sector is actually bigger than the private sector. And also, they are not the ones who are the main employers of labor, it's actually the state. And in getting the private sector in, there is nothing, you can work with the private sector, but you need to find a framework where you can work together. For instance, the private sectors and international development agencies right now, they come in, they negotiate with the government. Even when civil society organizations are complaining that the contracts, the framework is not pro-people, but they still work with the state. And also the state is right now doesn't work for the people. The state is corrupt, inefficient, but instead of listening to civil society organizations and try to work with them, they work with the state to stifle civil society organizations to better the life of the people. So definitely it is the rich that are getting richer and the poor are getting poorer. You don't even have a substantial middle class now in Africa. It's either the very rich or the poor.
Great, thanks so much. And thanks to everyone who's been participating today and sharing your thoughts in the chat. Please keep them coming. So let's spend the last 10 minutes of our webinar talking about alternatives. And I'd like to flag one of the targets of the SDGs that we mentioned in the beginning, which is target 5.4, specifically notes that we need to recognize and value unpaid care and domestic work through the provision of public services. Both of our speakers have already noted that donors are increasingly turning to the private sector to both finance and deliver on these promises. They've made it clear as well that P3s are not a suitable way to achieve these SDGs, especially when it comes to goals around gender equality. It's great to have two speakers from the Dawn Network, which is about alternatives. So let's start with Hussai. So you and Masaya have already laid out a comprehensive critique of P3s. Now, in particular, keeping in mind the pandemic response, what are some of the alternatives that you are proposing that speak directly to the importance of food security, energy, and access to land when we speak about valuing and recognizing the weight of reproductive work in the developing world? And if you can do about 2 minutes, that'd be great.
Okay. In terms of West Africa is diverse, but you can say, or even the African continent is diverse, but there are lots of similarities. And I would say that, first of all, we have to try, I don't know if I can say, we can't go back, we have to move forward. But in moving forward, we also have to bring in people. We have to think of people. Right now, all the development framework, whether we like want to accept or not, it's not pro-people. They are not pro-people. It's all profit, profit, profit. Even when we talk of what the Gates Foundation is doing, Ford Foundation, when you look at where they are investing to do their humanitarian or development work, they might be investing in fossil fuels. What does that mean for people and their environment? What does it mean for women, where the riverbeds are polluted with oil? So it means they won't have access to fishing. They will now need to go far off to satisfy their families. Now also, even in terms of, people are talking of solar as an alternative to fossil fuel. Yes, it's very important, but what's the cost? How many people can afford it? We have to think of affordability. The least, I was investigating solar because somebody is trying to get one and everything. The least you can get is $2,000. How many people can afford to keep that? And it's not even, it is just maybe an electric light, a fan, a fridge. Those little things that is not even sufficient for a family of five. So everything is over the top. I think we should find a framework where everybody thinks about reducing poverty. People don't think about reducing poverty at all. In Africa or West Africa or Sierra Leone in particular, the level of poverty is increasing by the year. Each government comes in, the level of poverty is increasing. And who suffers the most? It is women and their children. And who suffers the most? The girl child. Right now, with the coronavirus, parents were actually taking their children, offering their children in marriage because they cannot afford to feed them. So what does that mean? So I think we need a reorientation of our values. But everybody is just thinking of themselves. I don't even know what to say. I don't think the alternative is just that. We have to find a way.
Thanks, Hussai. So many of us have been critical of these trends towards the private sector in development for some time. And as you note, the pandemic has really intensified the needed response and exposed how ineffective, if not outright harmful, these responses can be. Messiah, let's turn to you about the question about finance in the global picture, and also to note that Canada gives a lot of money to development finance institutions in Africa as well. So I want to ask you about alternatives. In particular, what can donor countries like Canada do to make use of public aid money more effectively? And in particular, can you tell me more about the role of public money in supporting care work and or public services?
Okay, a lot of issues to tackle. Very briefly, I'll do my best. I think the issue of care and care provision has become essential. It has always been essential, and it has become obviously so in the context of the pandemic. The pandemic has had a heavy toll, not only in health systems, but also in public education, when many students and children in developing countries have not been able to attend schooling for as long as a year and a half. So a lot of investment needs to be channeled into public education, which in my view is part of care, of integrated systems of care that enable societies to share the responsibility to sustain the everyday conditions of living with the state, with communities, with the private sector, and the families. And as it is right now, it is families and communities that are really bearing the brunt of the care costs of the crisis, which of course have significant financial implications. So considering Canada's approach to foreign aid as a feminist approach would entail to support the strengthening of public education and public health services as a key starting point to the recovery that comes after the crisis. I think that donor countries need to honor their official development aid commitments. We speak about lack of resources when there are commitments in place that donor countries are barely, if at all, honoring. That would solve part of the financial scarcity. I think that donor countries need to apply at least the same standards that they would apply at home when fostering private investment in the delivery of infrastructure and services. We time and again find significant concerns in terms of transparency, in terms of accountability, in terms of prior and informed consent that are especially present in these processes in the Global South. So an issue of regulation here is central, and that's the importance of processes like the binding treaty ongoing in the United Nations for the last few years. Linking private investment with a human rights framework where the public sector, of course, participates, but does so in a way that is regulated and accountable to people. And I think it is important to remember that there are other initiatives to produce and to gather resources for development. One of them is the creation of a global tax authority to create new sources of revenue for governments to support and provide development programs, especially in the regions of the world where it's most needed. So I think we need to move past this idea of scarcity and look into existing options that do not punish the general population.
Great, thank you to both. And thanks to everyone for participating actively in the chat as well. I'm afraid we are running against the clock, and given the fact that we aim to end very soon, I want to give each of our guests a few moments to share any final thoughts or comments they have before we bring things to a close. In your final comments, it would be helpful if you could share a key message for our audience here in Canada. What should Canadian civil society and unions be doing? What's your ask for northern and donor countries? So let's start with Hussai. 1 minute.
Well, countries like Canada because everybody believes the Canadian government does well, they're not as, I don't want to name names, but a government like Canada should try and work with its civil society, organizations that promote gender equality, youth empowerment, empowerment of the poor, to ensure that they work with governments that are responsive, because that's the main thing we are having, not having governments that are responsive to the people. And they shouldn't, if you say you don't work with the governments, you actually punish the people, but you can work with the civil society groups that you know are transparent enough to work with people who need the services most, because the state is actually shirking its responsibility, and we shouldn't allow that to happen, especially with what is happening now. For instance, in Sierra Leone, what we're having now, currently civil society organizations are fighting with the government because they signed a secret deal with the Chinese to build a new fishing area. And people are demanding, what do we do? What? And I think there should be an international group, irrespective of where they are, that can, an international pressure group that can actually force governments, civil society, both in the global south and the north, to develop a new framework that would take into, that would take people's well-being at heart, because that is what is lacking now.
Great, thank you. So a new framework and civil society, key messages. Messiah, 1 minute for final remarks. Any thoughts to share?
Yes, I think the issue of accountability is key here. I think civil society in the global north needs to hold their governments accountable for what is done in their name in the global south. I think it is also important that civil society organizations from wealthy countries and from less wealthy countries and development regions actually build bridges and work together. So coalition building here is key transnationally, and there is a long history of transnational social movements that I think we can build on. Coalition building also includes, you know, creating bridges between unions and feminist organizations and other forms of citizenship politics that and denizens politics that build bridges across different peoples, transnationally and also across sectors.
Fantastic. Hussein, Messiah, an enormous thank you for sharing your time with us today and all the work you've done with Dawn. You've given us all a lot to think about, and I highly recommend that people read the report that you recently released. So I'd like to close, and I'd also like to let everyone know that our website has been updated with interviews from Canadian and global experts, including the Municipal Services Project, Public Services International, also an interview with Messiah and her colleague Karina Rodriguez Enriquez from Dawn. We're also continuing to engage with the Development Action Committee Civil Society Organization Working Group around private sector. We'll also continue to monitor the implementation of the federal budget's announcements on foreign aid, new projects undertaken by FinDev Canada, and other developments happening here and beyond, in Canada and beyond. So please have a look at our website and keep an eye out for these updates. So finally, a reminder that a recording of today's webinar will be posted to our website. And if you haven't already, please visit it and share it and our videos widely. With that, I'd like to thank you all for joining us today. Stay safe, everyone. Thanks so much.